All right, welcome back, Chemistry 241, gentlemen. This is our final new material lecture for the course, and you know, one of my favorites. So I'm going to go ahead and dive right in, and really kind of, I hope I'll do a good job of trying to connect all of this exam four material of molecular orbital theory all the way back to the stuff we covered in the very, very beginnings of the course, the exam one and exam two material dealing with crystal field theory and bonding of transition metal complexes and all those times, you know, we had, you know, things that would come up, observations that would kind of look weird and you'd say, well, how do we explain this using crystal field theory? And we really couldn't. And we told you, you know, a better theory of bonding was coming and well, guess what? You know it. It's called molecular orbital theory. And so you can take molecular orbital theory, believe it or not, and you can apply it to transition metal complexes. Now, there are some challenges when you do this because you can imagine, like the example we're going to do today with the octahedron, right? The old octahedral complexes, there are seven atoms, right? Seven atoms. And so that's going to be quite a challenge for you. I mean, for MO theory, we, you know, worked with one, you know, I'm sorry, two small molecules with two atoms or three atoms or maybe four or five, but now we're going to jump into seven. I'm going to show you that really it's not that hard if you just kind of keep your head on and think about how you can use your fundamentals that you just learned and apply it to something much more challenging, because that's what, you know, chemistry is. It's using the fundamentals to go tackle bigger and better and more exciting concepts and challenge yourself to build your skills. So, you know, I thought this was a good, you know, this is sort of the post-credit scene, if you will, of the course, right? You had your last exam and sort of, you know, you got your final exam coming up. So dig deep and keep working hard. So let's go ahead and talk about this. So before, when we dealt with crystal field theory, right, we talked a lot about a lot of the problems, right? And it's important for you to remember back in the day, crystal field theory, right? What was that all about? Well, that was about using an electrostatic model, right? That was really important. We talked about metals, right, having some positive charge, and most ligands using this model would be attracted to it based on the electrostatic Coulombic attraction. Positives and negatives, they attract each other, right? And that's really important. So what are some strengths? Well, it was really simple and hopefully pretty easy to understand. You know, it made pretty good predictions about the D subshell being split, right? And for octahedrals, we had, right, you had two up and you had three down, and that was your del oct, right? And that was not too hard. You could calculate that using UVVis and all kinds of good things, and we could talk about magnetic properties, and you did all this in lab. Now, it's also really important to realize there are a lot of problems with crystal field theory, and it may be a little while. You have to dust off the cobwebs in your head and go back to your notes, but one of the big problems is it assumed a localized interaction between an ion and a metal. You know, again, it really hyped on this idea of electrostatic interactions. If you remember what the spectrochemical series was, right, it was if you held the metal constant, the choice of ligand actually impacted the del O or whatever delta you were dealing with, and it really couldn't be explained really well. And why is that, right? Well, you know, we had no way of explaining neutral ligands, and we had a lot of really important neutral ligands like water and ammonia and carbon monoxide, right, carbonyl, and those really didn't apply to crystal field theory because crystal field theory is electrostatic, and it really talked about negative charged anionic ligands, and, well, that's not very satisfying. Unfortunately, if you use the theoretical math, which we really didn't talk about, behind crystal field theory, it doesn't really match experimental data, right? It doesn't match. And if it doesn't match the experimental data, well, your theory starts to get pretty tenuous, pretty weak, right? Because theories are only as strong as the theoretic or the experimental data that matches it. Because, well, what's the point? You can have all these really cool ideas, but if they don't match what you actually measure in the lab, you got a problem. And then finally, some things like pairing energies and bond distances, they don't really match that theory. And so at this point, you should probably be pretty tired of crystal field theory and say, well, okay, what's the next step then? What is the theory that would replace or supersede crystal field theory that would give us a contextual framework, a fundamental understanding that would allow us to both predict and explain phenomenon we measure in lab a hell of a lot better and more accurately than we could with crystal field theory? So what we end up doing gentlemen, is jumping into what we will call not crystal field theory, but ligand field theory, LFT. So make sure you know the term here. And in this case, ligand field theory is really just a fancy term for using MO theory that you just learned about in exam 4 and applying it to transition metals. And so what are some of the strengths? Well, one of the most important things is that it moves away from electrostatics and really focuses on a delocalized covalent bonding model. And that is going to be so powerful. So now we can really hype on the idea of Lewis acid, Lewis base adducts, right? Those are really important. You're going to form a covalent bond, and those are going to be what? Those are going to be shared electrons, and that's really important. That's something you could not do before in crystal field theory because you had no way of dealing with anything beyond just two opposite charged things attracting to each other. MO theory explains really well how you get that orbital splitting, and it explains the order of the spectrochemical series. It really helps you to address all of those neutral ligands that are really important that we couldn't really talk about before. And it also addresses, and again, I'm not going to go into all the detail here, all those theoretical problems that we had with the math not matching experiments really gets cleaned up here. And if we had a whole nother half semester, we could explore that. But for right now, just realize it really picks up the ball where crystal field fumbled. Now, the problem then is what? Well, as you probably just realized, you have to work your rear end off to understand what the hell is going on with MO theory. I would argue that crystal field theory is a lot easier to understand, but it's not very powerful. So here you have molecular orbital theory that can apply to anything, not just transition metals. It can apply to a lot of different things. And so if you can really work hard to understand that theory, you can apply it here and really get a much, much more powerful theory of bonding that will explain a lot of the errors or discrepancies we saw between experiment and your theoretical model that came up with crystal field theory. So really, this is quite literally the state of the art, most important modeling theory of bonding for the way transition metal complexes form. So we're gonna look at covalent bonding using MO, and that might seem a little scary, but I'm gonna walk you through it. So don't tune out quite yet. All right, so what I'm gonna do first is I'm gonna give you a hypothetical complex, and I'll just make one up. And so I'm making one up here. I've got cobalt and six hydrides. You might say, well, why'd you pick that one? Well, all I did was just pick a pretty simple one, right? I said, okay, I want to do what? Well, most importantly, I want to do what? I want to make sure I pick ligands that are going to do what for me? I'm going to pick ligands that are going to be really simple, because guess what? Remember, the number of atomic orbitals is going to equal number of molecular orbitals. So if I can keep the number of atomic orbitals on my ligands down, and I'm going to have, for an octahedron, six of these ligands, that'll make my life a lot easier, right? So if I pick a hydride, right? A hydride is two electrons, right? H minus. Both those electrons are probably going to be found in a 1s orbital. That means I have 1s times 6. It's only 6 atomic orbitals I got to worry about. If I'd pick something like chloro, I'm going to have, oh my goodness, I'm going to have the S in the valence shell, I'm gonna have the PY, the PX, the PZ, that's 4 orbitals times 6, right away that's 24 orbitals, and my life gets really hectic really quickly. So let's keep it simple right now. And cobalt is a very common metal, so you know, we can look that up. We can say, okay, well, if you go to your periodic table, and I've got the one from your last exam, so I'll pull that one up real quick. And if we look at cobalt, let's see here, what do we got? Cobalt is right here. It's got 9 electrons, right? You can see that right there. And I'll get that out of the way. We got cobalt, right? 9 electrons. And what's the oxidation number for that? Well, cobalt is 9 electrons minus 3, right? Because it's a 3 plus, right? Because the hydrides are negative. So it's going to be, what, 6 electrons, right? 9 minus 3 is 6. Okay, that's not too terrible, right? There we go. So 6 electrons on that cobalt. And then we're gonna have hydride, and I'm gonna write this down. Hydride has 2, right, 2 electrons. So 2 electrons times 6, that's gonna give us 12 electrons. So overall, this complex is gonna have 18 electrons. And if we think about it right, the number of atomic orbitals on hydride is going to be 1s times 6, which gives us 6 atomic orbitals on the hydrides for the ligands. I'll put a little L there for ligand. And then finally, we have to be careful. Oops, this should have been cobalt. Excuse the typo. So cobalt. And that one's going to give us what? Well, we're going to have what? We're going to have a 4s. We're going to have a 3d. And we're also going to have 4p. So there's one here. There's 5d orbitals. And there are 3p orbitals. So what does that give us? That gives us 5 plus 1 is 6 plus 3. That's 9 AOs from the metal. So overall, 6 plus 9, that's going to be a total of 15 atomic orbitals, as you know now, means that we have to deal with 15 atomic orbitals, giving us 15 molecular orbitals. And that's really important, right? Because orbitals have to be conserved. Now that seems a little daunting, 15, you've never seen something that complicated, but we're going to work through it. And what I want to do, and for me sometimes, since I'm a visual learner, I know some of you guys are visual learners, I like to begin, instead of trying to jump at an MO diagram, I'm going to start just by thinking about how things can be arranged. And I kind of visualize which orbitals on the metal are going to interact with which orbitals on the ligands, and what might this look like, and then we'll worry about building the diagram on the next page. So follow along with me. I'm going to do some of this, and you can do some of it on your own as well. So I'll leave some spots here where you can work on your own. Okay, but the first thing you might ask is, wait a minute, Dr. Porter, if I do the electron configuration for cobalt 3+, it only has 3D electrons. It only has 6 electrons in the 3D. What's going on? Why are you worried, Dr. Porter, about the 4s and the 4p? Well, you have to worry about them. And I put a little note here that even though some of the metal orbitals are not filled, they are still energetically close in energy to the ones that are partially filled, right? And so they're accessible to electrons. They have the same are a very similar proximity, and they have the correct symmetry to interact here. And so I think Dr. Cook showed you guys one example, I think it was beryllium hydride, where the p orbitals weren't filled, but they participated. And this is another good example of that. So if you need to go back and look at your notes from his lecture, please do that. But let's look at this first example. So what I've done is I've aligned my ligands along the negative and positive Cartesian axes, just like we did in crystal field theory. But I'm not going to do any kind of repulsion garbage like we did back then. What I'm going to do here is think about, okay, these are one possible arrangement of the ligand 1s orbitals that have 2 electrons each, right? Because it's still a Lewis base. Each one's a Lewis base. And those 2 electrons are going to mix or interact with the orbitals on the metal. And so if I've got my cobalt right here in the middle, right, my cobalt 3+, which orbital of the ones we just talked about would probably give you the best interaction with that arrangement of the 6 hydrides, right? So just to make sure, right, here's my hydride. Make sure we understand kind of what we're talking about here. These are my ligands, right, my 6 hydride ligands. And these are all 1s's, right? So I'll draw that here. That's a 1s orbital, nice sphere, right? And in this case, they're kind of lightly shaded. So I'm going to call these, I'll put positive for the shading here. Now remember, hydride's negative. These are not charges. They're just the amplitude of the wave function. If you want to, you could say in Spartan, these might be colored blue, okay? So what could we put? Which orbital could we kind of squeeze in the middle here at the origin to give me the best constructive overlap? Well, we have some choices, right? We could put a p orbital here, but p orbitals are kind of linear. They would only really interact with 2, so probably not a good choice. The d orbitals, they might interact with 2 or they might interact with 4, but there's nothing in terms of a single d orbital kind of mixed with all of them. So I'm going to kind of pick this 4s, right? And if I go here and I draw the 4s orbital kind of like that, right? This would be my 4s orbital, and if I phase it with the same phase, I'm going to get constructive overlap like nobody's business, right? This thing's going to be one big happy blob, and I'm going to try to draw it, you know, kind of like this. Back there's a little bit, and this whole thing is going to be shaded with a positive. So that's going to be a really nice sigma bonding interaction. However, if we do the antibonding combination, and I'll let you try to draw this one because it's hard to draw, you're going to get what? You're going to get a node here, a node here, a node here. You're going to get six nodes because what are you going to do? For the bonding combination, they all have the same amplitude, the same sign, right? All of these pluses will interact to give you one constructive overlap, one big blob. My art is garbage, I apologize. But over here, you're going to end up getting, I'll just flip the one in the middle. So I'll go ahead and change that color. And I'll say, okay, I'm going to draw this one here, right? And it's going to be here, and this is my 4S. And then I'm going to go ahead and try to do a little bit of a decent job. I'll put the one here. I'll put the one here. I'll put one out here in front. One back down there. One here. And then one back behind there. And the one thing I really want you to kind of point to here is that, check it out, we got a node here, 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 and a node here. So that's six new nodes. That's got to be high energy. And that's why I'm going to call that a sigma star, antibonding. So you kind of get the idea. And in fact, I'm not too happy with my first diagram, so I'm gonna erase this garbage and try to draw you something better, because, you know, we're all working together here. So let's see, maybe I can draw a nice, here's my nice 4S. I'll make this one here, and then I'll draw the one on top, right? I'll draw the one over here. I'll draw the one over here. There's the one over there in the back, the one out here, and then finally the one back there. So I think that looks much better, where you can see that you have nice constructive overlap, and you could draw that as one big cloud, kind of like what I tried to do before. But clearly, I think you see here that you really have what? You have zero nodes for this one. That's really low in energy, and that's going to be a really nice sigma bonding interaction. So that would be, you'd expect this bonding MO to be really low, probably our most stable MO diagram, our most stable MO. I'd say this would be really low in energy, and this one over here, the antibonding, is going to be really high because you got six nodes. Okay, so there's one good example. Now, if we come down here, check this out. This is where we can have a hydride, right? And we can put a positive there and a negative down here. Now, you might say, well, what happened to these guys? Well, in this case, in the top one, we had zero nodes. In this one, we're going to see one node, and guess where it is? To me, it looks like the node is where? In this case, there's a node that equals what? It's going to be the XY plane. And if that plane is a node, then it kills all of these interactions here, and so they don't contribute. Okay, so now, if you think about this, this is the Z-axis here. Which orbital on the metal would best interact here? Well, let's see, I've already kind of taken care of my S. I've got some D orbitals, but man, doesn't that just beg to, if we put a P orbital on here, right? We could have put a P orbital here. Again, this one's gonna be here. We could put one down here, right? So you have this one here, and you have this one up here, right? That looks pretty good. Okay, so if we get a bonding interaction, we're gonna have this big, you know, I can draw the whole thing here. And then if you'll let me draw the bottom one down here, and there you go. So I would argue that you started with one node. Yeah, you still have one node, but you didn't introduce any new nodes. So I'm gonna call this a sigma, because I think that's nice constructive overlap here, right? If I draw this as a red one, it might make you feel a little bit better about it. If I draw this one as a blue one, there you go. And so constructive overlap here, just constructive overlap down there, and you get this nice interaction. Well, if I flip it, right, if I flip it, and I'll flip the one down here in the middle, the P orbital, and again, which orbital is that? Well, that's gonna be the what? That's gonna be the 4P Z in this case, because we're talking about the Z axis, right, pointing in that direction. I'll flip the bottom and make the bottom one positive, and then I'll take this red and make this top one negative. And now you'll see it looks like we have an antibonding combination. That's a sigma star, right? Because now we've got what? We've got, I would argue, two brand new nodes. So two new nodes, right? that we didn't have before. So that's going to raise that energy and support the fact that this is probably going to be deconstructive interference, an antibonding interaction, sigma antibonding, right? No pi here. We're not going to form any pi bonds to hydride. That's really important. So there you go. Now, if we do a very similar thing for the next one, guess what we have? In this case, we have the node. The starting node is the, well, it looks like that is going to be, let's see if I have to scroll up to see my axes. That looks like, this looks like it's going to need to be the XZ. And in this case, we want to use, can you figure out which one we're going to use? Because it looks like this is along X, and I will just double check that. I have to look up above. Nope, that's Y. Sorry, that's Y. I can't read today. Let me erase that, and there you go. Yeah, getting a little sleepy here. Okay, that's going to be along Y, right? Because this is Z and this is X, so the XZ plane is where the node is, just like we saw up here. And so we probably want to use what? We probably want to use the 4PY, right? And that would be something that looks going to look like this, right? You're going to have maybe the same thing you saw above, right? There's the plus, and if we want to kind of do the same thing here, we're going to have this one here, and there you go. And I can kind of draw that for you if that will make you feel better. Doesn't really matter to me. Again, I'm not going to be known for my artistic ability there, but I think you can get an appreciation for what I'm trying to show you. So in this case, this is exactly the same. What do you notice here? Well, it's exactly the same symmetry. It differs only in direction. So my guess is we may begin to kind of sniff out the fact that these are probably going to be degenerate. They're probably going to have the same energy, right? Now, I'll let you draw the bonding and antibonding because I did the same thing up above. And then the last one, I would argue here, okay, what do we got here? Well, this one, again, just another permutation, right? We've got Z and we've got Y. So the starting node here is what? It is the YZ plane. So we better use the one here, right? This is going to be X. And so now we want to probably use the 4PX, which is our last P orbital. And I'll go ahead and draw that one for you, just to try to make it a little bit easy. It's hard because it's kind of coming in and out of the paper here, but I think it'll let you get a little bit of an idea of kind of what we're talking about. And that's all that's really important. Okay. And again, there's really nothing here that's totally unfamiliar to you. We're just using a little bit more complicated set of orbitals. But, you know, I would argue again that these three, right, these are all based on 4P, X, Y, and Z, and they differ only in direction, right? Directions typically don't change energy, so I'd say they're going to have the same energy, and that's really important. So that means you're going to see probably something that looks like this, where you're going to have three bonding, and you're probably also going to have three antibonding that are at the same energy, right? And so these are going to be degenerate, and that's really important for you to consider, because we saw examples of this idea of degeneracy back in our previous exams worth of material. So there we go. We've used the metal S orbital and the 4S, and we've used the metal 4Ps. So what are the only ones that are left? You got it. Only the D orbitals, probably one of the most important sets of orbitals, right, for transition metals that we talked about. So here's one example, right? Okay, now you'll see we actually have two nodes, right? So two starting nodes where it kind of looks like, you know, it's hard to see, but I would say that you start with two nodes now, because if you think about it, S orbitals, they have no node that you can see, and then the P orbital has one node to begin with, so that made sense on the previous three that we started with. The D orbitals have two nodes, if you look at the way they look, because here, remember, we're going to go with, and I'll go ahead and label this for you, we're going to have this plus and this plus, and then these darker ones are going to be negatives and negatives. And so in order to make this happen, we kind of had to cross two nodes, right? And that's really important because there are two nodes here. I'm not going to name the planes because they're kind of in between the axes, so don't worry about that mathematically. But anytime you change from a positive to a negative, you have to go through zero, and that's a node by definition. And so you have two nodes here. So this probably is a really good indicator we're probably going to need what the d orbitals, right? Okay, just like we talked about. So let's see if we can draw these. So in this case, we need something that's going to fit right along the axes, right? So something like that. And again, this is what? This is along x, and this is along y. And so, you know, if you don't remember your d orbitals, I am really ashamed for you. But there you go. And if you look at that, right, check this out. We've got a set that looks like this, right, where we've got positive and positive. And in this case, right, they sit along the axes. So we're going to need what? We're going to need the 3D. Which D orbital sits along X and Y? You got it, X squared minus Y squared. And that's really important. So now we can draw a bonding constructive overlap version. And I'll try my best to kind of draw it as best I can. Right? That's going to be along X and along Y, right? And you're going to have something that looks like that, right? Just amplified. There you go. That's definitely going to be constructive. And again, that is a nice sigma bonding orbital. Why? Because you still have two nodes, but no, right? I'll say no new nodes, right? We started with two. We ended up with two, so we didn't change anything. So that's nice constructive overlap. And for antibonding, I'll try my best here. Let's see, I'll do this one and this one, right? And then I'll go over here. I'll try to draw this one here, and then we said these guys are gonna look like that. Oh, wait, I flipped the wrong one. Okay, I was flipping the middle ones before, so I'm gonna keep that consistent. I flipped the metal orbital on the previous example, although it doesn't really matter. You could have flipped the ligands, it doesn't matter, but I'm going to keep it consistent as best I can so you guys don't get confused. There we go. That looks probably a little bit more in terms of what you were expecting. There we go. Right, and this is along X, this is along Y, and this now we have what? We have 1, 2, 3, 4 new nodes that we did not have before. So that's going to be high in energy. Why? Because it's deconstructive, right? Deconstructive overlap. So that means we're going to get antibonding interactions. So that is going to be a sigma star like you wouldn't believe. And then the last one, well, we have 5D orbitals. We've used one. Check this one out. Okay, well, what do we got? We got these guys that are aligned like this, and we've got two that are like that. And I'll go ahead and let you think a little bit. What d orbital might fit well into here? We need something along, this is the first time we've seen for the d orbital, something along z, and then we need something both along y and x. What could we use? Well, how about we use the 3D z squared. And I'll try my best to draw it. Let's see if I can draw this. We're gonna have a positive lobe there, positive lobe down here. And do you remember the fun thing about dz squared? We had the donut, right? Do you remember the donut? Yeah, the donut kind of did something like that. I kind of exaggerated the donut, but I think you can see here that that donut is gonna have constructive overlap with all four of those. Whereas the ones along the z-axis are going to have constructive overlap with the vertical ones. And that's really neat. And so I'll try to draw this one for you over here. You know, we'll try to draw that like that, where you have that and that. And then we're going to get this kind of odd looking, I don't know, it's going to be kind of like that, 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 and then the little donut. So this is going to be constructive overlap. So here you have no new nodes, but I would argue this is going to be sigma bonding. And it's sigma bonding still, right? You're not going to form pi bonds to hydride. Now this guy over here is going to be kind of a monster. So I need to kind of flip the middle, right? Flip the d orbital here. So I'm just going to flip that. And then I'm going to make my donut blue, kind of like that, if you will, right? we can kind of do that. And then these up top, right, positive, those are not going to be very happy. You're going to get some pretty strong deconstructive overlap. And then these that's a negative, red's negative. There we go. We'll change that one back. And then we'll put this one out here. We'll put this one out here. And this one back here. So again, this is X, this is Y, and up top is Z. And so here, oh my goodness, what do you got? What do we got? We got, I would say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 nodes. Oh, that's kind of crazy. Yeah, so that's gonna be, I would argue, pretty strongly sigma star interaction. Okay, so if you've noticed though, we're all out. And so we don't have any additional combinations because we've used all of the different permutations of the ligands, right? We had the S combination, the P combination, and the D combination. And so that's a total of 6, right? And we only have 6 ligands, so we're kind of out of permutations of the 6 atomic orbitals. So we don't have any that can interact. And so we have a couple that are left. And can you name the ones that didn't get to play with us? Well, I would say that those are gonna be what? They're gonna be the 3D XY. They're gonna be the 3D, can you think of it? XZ, and they're gonna be the 3D YZ. And those all kind of look the same. I'm not gonna draw them all for you because you should be able to draw those orbitals on your own, but I'm just going to kind of draw them, right? Because these are the ones that are going to fit, in fact, they fit in between the axes, right? And I'll try to just draw this one here. So I'll go X, Y, and do kind of a cross section. And remember, these go in between the axes, right? We're going to have positive, negative. And the reason they're non-bonding, right, is because what if you did try to put a ligand here? What if you tried to put a ligand? Well, you'd have equal amount of deconstructive and constructive. So this would form really no net interaction either way. So you're just gonna not have any bonding. You're not gonna have any non-bonding, or you're not gonna have any anti-bonding. So I gave away the answer. Obviously, these are gonna be what? These are all gonna be non-bonding MOs that are gonna have what? They're gonna have the same energy, right? The same energy. They're going to be something like this, right? They're going to have 3 degenerate non-bondings where you're going to have DXY, DXZ, and DYZ. And they will have the same energy as what? The 3D level in the AOs, right? That's really important. You've seen examples of non-bonding before. This is just a little bit more complicated. So again, they don't form bonding or antibonding combinations because they don't align with any of the ligands. So there you go. So now that we kind of know what's going on, we can put this all together. And if I can kind of get my screen to scale down a little bit, put this all on here, we can begin to see what's going on. And so this is not that hard to understand. We've got the 3D, we've got the 4S and the 4P, and I've kind of spread them out, but they're going to be really close in energy. And we said we have 6 electrons for cobalt, right? Don't forget, this is cobalt 3+, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and oops, that was all we had, right? We only had 6 electrons. So please make sure to count your electrons, right? This is gonna be 3D, 6, right? There we go, I can count today finally. So 6 electrons there. And then what about these guys? We've got 6 times hydride, right? And each hydride has 2 electrons, so that's gonna be 1, 2, right? Because this is gonna be 1 hydride. Another hydride, and so on and so forth. So we have 6 hydrides where they each bring a lone pair. And this is really good evidence for the fact that these are Lewis bases, right? Don't forget that. And so now what we can do, right? Here we have our MO diagram, and there's some things that you can probably look at, right? Like this one down here, I would argue would be my sigma. And I'm gonna call this my S because it came from, right? It came from the 4S from the metal. These 3, right, are going to be sigma. I'll call them sigma P's because they came from the 4 P's. And then these 2, right, I'm going to call these sigma D because they came from the DX squared minus Y squared, right? And they came from the D z squared. So these are all bonding, right? These are all bonding. And then what are these three? Well, notice these three aren't connected to anything over on the ligand side, so they're only connected to metal, so that's a good indicator that these are our non-bonding, right? And this is gonna be essentially DXY, this is DXZ, and this is DYZ. What about these two up here? Well, remember, for every bonding combination, we're probably gonna get an antibonding combination that we drew up above, so this would be the sigma star that belongs to the D's. This is gonna be the sigma star that belongs to the P's. And then this one, right? I'll keep the consistency here as best I can. There we go, draw that. Came from the P combinations. And then the last one is gonna be a sigma star that comes from the S combination. And it kind of makes sense, right? The S combination gave us the best overlap, but it also gave us a lot of deconstructive overlap too. So these are really far apart. And then here again, we can see the three P's that are gonna be degenerate, right? The three P bonding, sigma bonding orbitals that came from the four P, right? Those came from X, Y, and Z. So we have three. And then notice this. This is something that might not have been intuitive to you. Even though they don't look the same mathematically, when you solve the differential equations or if you use Spartan, you find out that these are degenerate, as are the non-bonding, right? We talked about these are all very similar, they differ only in direction. And so now what we can do, right, we can take the 12 electrons over here, we can take the 6 electrons over here, and now we have 18, right? Oh, look at that, 18 electrons, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. Now granted, you could have gone higher and above, but that's our 18. What's the bond order? The bond order looks like, right? Bond order for this equals 6, right? We have 12 minus 0, because non-bonding don't count. 12 minus 0 divided by 2 is bond order of 6, and that's pretty consistent with what we've seen before. Nothing too crazy there. Now, a couple things that are really neat to see. Look at these bonding sigma orbitals down here, right? Which orbital on the other side in terms of the atomic orbitals are they closest to? Well, I would argue the ligands are closest to the bonding, so you can kind of think about this as the ligands have the more bonding character because they're closer to these ligands or these molecular orbitals than energy. And so this is a good piece of evidence for the fact that these are Lewis bases, right? They are donating those electrons and helping to form that bond, and that's really important. Whereas these non-bonding electrons up here are smack darn right equivalent to the original atomic orbitals of the cobalt. So these non-bonding ones are gonna be more related to the cobalt. And if you look at this, in fact, if you look at this, right, check this out. This is really important. Check out what we have right here. That is probably, at least I hope, a little bit familiar to you. Do you remember we had 2 up top, 3 down here? And what do you think this is? This, my friends, is del O. Not derived from crystal field theory, but derived from molecular orbital theory. And in fact, we could label these. This would be the LUMO up here, right? These would be the HOMO. So the HOMO-LUMO gap is the same as del O, and that's pretty amazing. This really shows you that why would you not want to put electrons up here? Why? Because you'd be putting them into an antibonding orbital. Right? And if you put electrons into an antibonding orbital, you destabilize the entire complex because you reduce its bond order. So if you could, you'd rather probably keep these guys low. And in this case, you'd like to stay low spin. But again, the same things apply as you think about as these bonds get stronger. These antibonding get higher in energy, so the gap, the del O gap, is kind of based upon how strongly bonding these ligands are. That's really quite unique that we couldn't see that before, and using the power of covalent bonds, you can really see what's going on here that you couldn't see before. So, anyway, I really hope this really shows you how powerful using molecular orbital theory can be when you think about something like this. And you know, it's a nice way of tying what we just did to something that we did before and understanding it in a new, and I would argue much more sophisticated and in a much more powerful way using a new theory. Okay, so what we could do now is, if we really wanted to, I could jump into Spartan, I could draw this, do some calculations. However, Spartan has a problem. Whenever you deal with Spartan with transition metals, Spartan kind of starts to cry. Spartan was not designed for transition metals. It was typically designed for main group S&P block elements like your carbons and your organic molecules you'll get to deal with if you go into organic chemistry. Well, whenever you throw in a lot of electrons, like transition metals tend to have, those calculations grind to a halt because there are a lot of calculations that you know, it takes more computing power to deal with more electrons. Bottom line. However, we can still look at it. And so on the next page, you'll see a really nice diagram from Spartan output that you can use to derive your table. Now, you know how to do this by now, so I'm not going to go into all the gory detail here. However, let's look at some of our old throwbacks. And so when you look at this, the first thing I do is I get rid of what? I get rid of the core electrons. And so you can kind of see, are there any core electrons? Well, we start at one. Oh, okay, well, huh, interesting. There are no negative hundreds or anything, so we're okay there. Now, right away, you'll start to look for a homolumo gap, right? Because you're looking for negatives and positives. Well, unfortunately, for the Hartree-Fock STO3G, this is a notoriously poor calculation for transition metals. So one of the errors it gives us is that it doesn't give us any negatives and positives. So that's kind of a pain. So we have to kind of deal with that. But it's not so bad, right? We can deal with that. We can kind of figure it out on our own. And one way you can do it, well, first of all, let's get rid of the eigenvalues. We're still not ready to deal with eigenvalues. And again, I'm just going to look at this top run rank right here. We're going to get rid of what? We don't care about the cobalt S, right? 1S. We don't care about the 2Ps. We don't care about anything until we get to what? Oh, no. What did Spartan do? Ah, check it out, right? What happened here? Spartan, for the first time, jumped to the chase, right? In this case, it only gave us the valence. It gave us what? And this is really important that we think about this. We've got to really be careful here. So what do we got here? We got a hydride, 1. We got hydride 2, 3, 4, 5 through 6. So these are all 1s's, no problem. But here, Spartan actually was able to kind of truncate some of the data for us and remove those core electrons. So now we have 4s, 4px, 4py, 4pz, 3, and this is kind of weird, this is dx squared, this is z squared, this is dx squared minus y squared, and then here you go, these are the rest of the d orbitals. So you can kind of see what's playing here. So you're okay, there's nothing to really cut out here, and then you can begin to look at the energies, right? What do you notice about these two? These two are degenerate, right? And remember, the degenerate ones dealt with, you got it, the d orbitals. And then we have what? We've got 1 by itself, and that one dealt with, well, what did it deal with? It dealt with, it looks to me like the s orbital, right? The 4s on cobalt. And then you have 1, 2, 3 that dealt with the 4ps, right? So here's a 3d, this is going to be the 4s, and then you got the 4ps. So Spartan kind of did a little bit of a I'd say it's not so accurate, but basically it did this, right? Instead of what you saw up above, it did 2, 1, and 3, but the energies are so close together, it's not a big deal, and these are going to be our sigmas. This would be sigma D, sigma S, and sigma P, and these are all going to be filled by ligand electrons, right? No big deal. And then you look over here, and you can begin to say, okay, well, I've got 3 degenerate ones here, and if I kind of look at these, this is where we start to have some problems, right? Because what would you expect these to be? You'd expect these to be what? You'd probably expect them to be these, right? You'd expect them to be what? You'd expect them to be these non-bonding ones, right? Well, unfortunately, Spartan drops the ball here, and it doesn't give us what we needed here. So you say, what the hell, Spartan? And so now we can begin to see, and you can kind of chew on this on your own. In fact, If you want to, you can kind of work on it. The antibondings are a little bit better, but I'm really disappointed here that Spartan didn't give us the non-bonding that we expected. It got the energies right, but not the contributions. So what I'm trying to show you here is not to freak you out or anything, but again, to show you some limitations of the Spartan program, because the Spartan program, at least for the level of calculation I was working on, this Hartree-Fock level at STO3G, I would argue it's a fast calculation, but we've lost so much accuracy. It's okay in terms of giving us the energy, but the contributions are kind of circumspect at best. And so if you really wanted to do this calculation with Spartan, you pretty much would have to crank it up to semi-empirical level calculation, a density functional theory calculation, and you'd have to really do some higher level calculations to really get at some of the stuff that we want to see as a good calculation, stuff that matches our data, right? And so the bad thing here is that it doesn't really work out. And so the problem is, guess what? You'd have to submit this calculation, probably wait a few hours or even a day or something and get this to work. So anyway, I'm just trying to show you that, again, Spartan is a calculation tool that works pretty well. And I would argue you get some useful information out of here, but just not the same level of accuracy that we're used to for the smaller molecules. So more electrons, more error, at least for the Hartree-Fock lower level calculations. But again, you can fix that by doing more complicated ones. You can use like Dr. Feller's supercomputing cluster, and you could do all kinds of fun stuff. But for right now, don't worry about it. Okay, the last thing I want to mention is, if you remember way back in the spectrochemical series, right, you had things that the ligand order, so you had like chloride, you had, you know, halogens, and then you had on the other side things like CO, right? Things that had pi bonds. And so what explained, you know, so over here these would be, just to refresh your memory, this would be a small delo. Over here, these ligands gave you a large delo, and these guys in the middle were somewhat, you know, you had things like water and ammonia, you know, things kind of in the middle, right? Okay. So the last thing I want to mention is a little bit about pi bonding. Now previously, I only showed you sigma bonding. And why is that? Well, because hydrides can't pi bond. Hydrogen can't pi bond. And so what happens though if we go from hydride to something like chloro? Chloro, right? Chloro has lone pairs, right? If I draw a metal with a chloro bound to it, I used one, right? I use one lone pair to form the sigma bond. However, I've got three extra lone pairs just kind of floating out here. They typically live in what? They're going to be in p orbitals. Now, what can we do? And more precisely, you know, how could they interact with a metal? Well, remember, we accounted for the sigma bonding way back in our previous table, and we said, okay, sigma bonding is pretty cool. We can deal with that, but pi bonding is kind of tough. So, unfortunately, all the d orbitals are taken, right? Not all of them, right? So if I took a metal and I drew one of those non-bonding interactions, right? Something like this. Okay, fix that up a little bit. If I had one of those non-bonding, so I could do something, I don't know, I can call this, we can call this Y, we can call this X, and this would be the 3D XY orbital, right? And we could say that there is a sigma bond here with chloro, and I'm going to draw a p orbital that has two electrons in it, one of my lone pairs that lives in a p orbital. Check this out. Now one of these non-bonding, right, this non-bonding orbital could interact with a non-bonding lone pair, a non-bonding pair, and look what you've got. You've got potential to form something really cool. If that lone pair can donate into the metal, you can form a pi bond between chloro, right? You still have the sigma, don't forget about that, but now you formed a pi bond. And that pi bond's gonna look something like this, right? There we go. So you can shade that if you want to. This is a very special kind of pi bond. This is a P to D pi bond. And when that happens, this kind of interaction, it can happen through the molecule. It can convert all three of those non-bonding orbitals into pi bonding orbitals, and that can reduce the value of del O and make it small. Now, the actual reasons for why this happens are a little bit beyond what we're talking about, but forming that pi bond will shorten or shrink del O, and that's why things like chloro, bromo, fluoro, things of multiple lone pairs in p orbitals can form these pi bonds. Again, this D to P pi bond, which is really kind of fancy here. This is also gives the chloros, right? Chloro then is what we call a pi donor ligand. And why is it called that? Because it's donating the electrons to form that pi bond. The ligand, right? That's going to be ligand to metal pi donation to form that really fancy bond. That's kind of cool. Well, if that happens on one side of the spectrochemical series, what do you think is going to happen on the other? Well, what can happen? We can have that same setup, right? We can have Y and X, and we can draw our metal, and it can have this nice non-bonding, right? This is going to be a non-bonding 3DXY, and we'll draw it something kind of like this, right? And then we've got a carbonyl, right? Carbonyl's here. And the lone pair on that carbon is what forms the sigma bond. Well, guess what? This has a pi bond, right? But if it has a pi bond, it also has a low-lying pi star that can be accessed. So this gentleman is a pi star. And for carbonyl, that pi star, if you want to, you can actually go draw the MO diagram for carbonyl and find out that pi star is empty. So what can happen is the electrons from the non-bonding interaction on the metal can be donated back. So this is opposite of what was happening up here with chloro, right? Chloro would be a pi donor. We now form a new pi bond. So we form a new pi bond. And this is going to look kind of different. You're going to have this above and below overlap. And so we're going to have metal carbonyl, right? And then we're going to have this here. So here we have our positive at the bottom, negative over here. And then we're going to have the leftover lobes over here that didn't do much. Same thing for the carbonyl. And now we have a pi bond. And this is very different. This is a metal to ligand pi acceptor. So pi acceptor is the term for the carbonyl kind of ligand, right? So this is metal to ligand pi acceptance. So up above a chloro, chloro donates. Chloro has lone pairs. Chloro will donate the electrons to form the pi bond. So chloro, the halogens, things that have multiple lone pairs, those will be pi donors. Whereas things that have multiple bonds, things like carbonyl, things like, if we go back up top, right, we can say, oh, things like carbonyl, things like cyano, right, things like nitro, all nitrosyl, right, all kinds of these things that have lone pairs, these are going to be, so these guys over here have large del O's because they are pi acceptors, whereas these guys over here are going to have small del O's because they're pi donors. And that's really important. So this explains things that we couldn't explain before. There was no way you could use crystal field theory to explain the spectrochemical series, but by using MO diagrams, you can. And so once again, for the pi donors, they reduce del O. Pi acceptors increase del O through these neat interactions. So in the case of pi donors, they put more electrons on the metal, shrinks del O. The carbonyl takes electrons away from the metal, increases del O, and that really gives you the idea here of why the spectrochemical series works. And so here's a final little takeaway note here. There you go, my pen will work a little bit better there. All right, so here you can see that once again, things on the far side here, especially these guys right here, don't worry about thiocyanate too much in this one, but these guys are going to be your pi donors, whereas these guys over here, especially these, are going to be your pi acceptors. And then things like water and some of the guys in the middle here, they're not going to do much of either. So again, over here you're going to have a very small del O, And over here, you're gonna have very high delos. And in the middle here, it's kind of a spectrum. So this kind of summarizes what we just talked about. If there's no pi interaction, then like we talked about before, the stronger the ligand, the lower those orbitals are gonna be, the bigger your delo is gonna be. However, if there is pi interaction, small delos are a result of pi donors. And so it's right here, right? Small delos are a result of pi donors. Large delos are going to be pi acceptors. So it's a good kind of rule of thumb. That is explained through MO theory. And there we go. We just talked about that. So in a nutshell, I kind of run a few minutes over, but that's okay because I think this is really cool stuff. This is our last lecture. I can speak for Dr. Cook to say that, you know, we really enjoyed interacting with you guys. The first half of the semester was a blast. I really enjoyed having office hour visits and hanging out with you guys in the lab and our pizza review sessions. It seems like forever ago, but really, really just had a great time getting to know you guys. And please don't be a stranger. You know, hopefully we'll all get together in the fall. Maybe we can have a 241 reunion pizza party or something just for fun. I think that's a good idea. I think we'll do that. And then, you know, the second semester, you guys worked so hard to stay on top of things and to stay engaged online. And Dr. Cook and I worked really hard to make this course as strong as we could for you guys, so you'll be best prepared moving on in your chemistry studies. But be safe, hang in there, and just be strong and do the best you can to social distance and keep this nasty thing from rebounding twice as bad as it has been already. So hang in there, sit tight, and try to enjoy the summer a little bit, and work hard and finish well and do well in this final exam. So again, it's open notes just like we did before, and my heart goes out to you guys. Stay strong, and may you and your families be well and safe, and I look forward to seeing you all in the fall. Take care.